grown by 10% per year for more than a decade, to the point where the reimbursement line item that was in the state budget was running $400 million a year. And despite growing $400 million a year, there were 425 projects on the waiting list. Over the last year, year and a half, there have been a number of people meeting to kind of to try to come up with a solution to that problem and make good on the promise that the state had made to the city's intent. There was a lot of back and forth with the House, the Senate, the Speaker's Office, the Senate President's Office, interested members of the legislature, even in, with the administration, to come up with a reform plan that people could sign on to. The ultimate product of those negotiations were passed by the legislature in July. And signed by the governor in July, it was passed pretty much unanimously in both the House and the Senate. It's a bipartisan bill that people signed on to, and that brings us to where we are today. The reform is somewhat complicated, but we've given you a handout, and really I'm going to speak from a little chart that's in the back of that handout. I've covered a number of the bullet points that are in there. What the state's chosen to do is take this program off budget, create an off budget trust into which the resources of revenue are going to go. Most notably, a penny in the state sales tax is going to be dedicated. One penny of the 5 pennies in the state sales tax is going to be dedicated to this off budget trust. It won't be a full penny right away. It can be phased in over a 7-year period in order to mitigate any impact it would otherwise have on the budget. Legislature made very clear to us that it would have been irresponsible for us to dedicate a penny and solve this problem and then create a hole into the budget and create problems and not be able to fund Chapter 70 or local aid or any of the other programs that still rely on the budget for funding. Two other sources of revenue that go into the soft budget trust are $150 million in cash that came from the fiscal year over surplus and $1 billion in proceeds from state general obligation funds, which will be done in two $500 million pieces, one in 05 and one in 06. In addition, and as is necessary to deal with the problem, the trust itself will be able to issue debt and repay it from any of the sales tax that will come in over time. With those sources of revenue going to this off-budget trust, which, by the way, is managed by a new authority, which is controlled by a 7-member board, representatives of the administration, the treasurer serves as chairman of that that authority and appoints a number of members to the board. That authority and this trust needs to be able to do three things and can do three things based on the financial modeling that we've done. The first thing that it has to be able to do is pay off all the old commitments for projects that were already funded. Those commitments total $5.5 billion over the next 20 years. Those are reimbursements that are already due to cities and towns who had projects that were approved by DOE, which were funded in the budget in prior years, but for which we may owe 1 payment, 5 payments, 10 payments, up to 20 payments, 20 years of payments for some of the more recent projects. That's the first thing that the new authority of the trust has to be. The second thing that it needs to be able to do, and really the problem that confronts the legislature and us as we try to do the financial modeling, is we need to be able to fund the waiting list. And folks made it, your representatives, other representatives made it very clear that we need to be able to fund the entire waiting list, and no one is going to get cut from the waiting list, and anybody who's on the waiting list is going to get the full percentage reimbursement that they were promised. This authority will be able to fund every project, all 425 projects that are on the waiting list over the next 3.5 years. And we're going to be able to do that in a way that is different from the way it was done in the past. In the past, cities and towns went out and had to bond for the entire cost of a school building project. Then the state would reimburse over typically 20 years in annual payments to basically help get the debt service on those bonds. In the future, what the authorities will be able to do is pay lump sum payments for the state share of projects so that cities and towns will not have to bond for the state share of the project. They'll only have to bond for the local share of the project. The only caveat I would make to that is that if some cities and towns went out and bonded more than their share of a project already, we're going to have to work out an even schedule in those cases. But it's certainly the intent of the new authority to make lump sum payments for the state share so that you don't have to count on getting payments from the state over a period of 20 years. The third thing that that the authorities are going to be able to do, and ask people to respond to the schools. This is, as I said, a program that's been running since 1948. Just because we have a large waiting list now, we know that doesn't mean that there won't be future school projects. There's financial capacity built into this authority and into this model such that when the current moratorium is over, there is a moratorium on accepting new and funding new school building projects that didn't make the wait list that runs through July 1st of 2007. When that moratorium is over, this authority will be able to fund roughly $800 million a year in new school projects each and every year after the moratorium is over. $500 million of that being the state share, the balance being the local share. That, in a nutshell, is the reform. We'll certainly be here to answer questions when we're done. But at this point, I wanted to turn it over to Tim, who has, was mentioned, interim executive director of the new authority, and is in charge of a lot of the implementation. And I'll turn it over to him to talk about the implementation of the authority and also to give you some of the figures with regard to the specific projects in the cities and towns that you all obviously care about.
Thanks, Joe. I think one very challenging thing for us in implementing this reform has been the fact that this program has a hard start. It started on, the legislation was passed on July 28th, and the authority took over on July 28th. And we've been scrambling ever since to get the authority up and running and to get going on this program. We think a lot about the waiting list, but the school building assistance program is an ongoing program. Our contract assistance payments on 700 different projects that are going out on a regular basis. And one of the first things that we had to do was make sure that we made the September payment was according to plan. So we've been working on getting that set up. Obviously, as a new authority, we have to establish an office, hire staff, bring over a lot of the DOE people, maybe all of them who work on SBA, and then also add to that, because I think one of the problems for the SBA program in the past has been funding, but another has been obviously staffing and being able to deal with the huge nature of this program. As far as the old projects go, we're not really done with the old projects. We have a backlog of about 350 audits on projects that are receiving contract assistance payments. And the way that works is that you're not familiar with it, if you're driving a school that has one of those payments, is that take on a 20-year payment stream, and we'll start paying you at the amount that originally were approved at, and then subsequent to that, we'll do an audit and adjust your payments. Well, your payment then can go up or down depending on what the audit results are. And the problem was with the audits being backlogged sometimes, as much as the waiting list was backlogged, up to 10 years, trying to make an adjustment on the 10-year payment stream, and adjusting for payments that were made incorrectly for 10 years, leads to a very large adjustment, doubles the adjustment that has to be made in the out years. So we have a big issue, we have a lot to do with catching up on the projects that are receiving payments on them. We certainly aren't losing sight of that. We need to get the waiting list clear. I'll talk about that in a moment, but at the same time, we want to clean up what's been done with the existing projects. As far as the waiting list goes, that's the other kind of major thing that needs to happen. And we're committed under this reform to pay $4.5 billion over the course of $5.5 billion actually over the course of 3.5 years, and we need to get at least $1.5 billion out the door during this fiscal year, which has only 9 months left. So we have to get going on getting the waiting list paid. So what we're doing with that is concentrating on the first probably get to about 125-130 projects a year. As we move through it, so we're concentrating right now on the first 25 projects, among them Ascanomic, which is right up at the top, and we're going to work with those schools and towns to try to come up with all the issues. Those projects also have to be audited before we can get payments, and we have a problem there with, because we're making a lump sum payment, the audit has to be done before we give you the amount, because there's no future payments to make adjustments on. Probably what we'll do, at least with these front projects that are fiscal 05, is probably do a 75% initial payment and adjust 25% payment once the audit is complete. We hope eventually, with waiting list projects, to be able to make a lump sum to finish the audit before the payment is due, and to make a lump sum payment aren't any outstanding issues going forward. And how does that relate to projects that we have here around Middleton? We have a couple of handouts here. One is for Representative Hill's district, and one is for Representative Jones's district. But I think the impact is fairly dramatic on these. For example, in Linfield, and we'll have the sheets out here in a minute, Linfield has four projects on the waiting list. It's Linfield Middle School, the Huckleberry Hill Elementary, Summer Street Elementary, and Linfield High School. These projects were originally going to receive reimbursement in, for the Linfield Middle School, it's going to be in fiscal 08, and for the others in fiscal 09.
And just to interrupt, that's when you're going to get your first payment.
First 20. Instead, these projects, with these, all except for the Linfield High School, will receive payment for the 05, a lump sum, assuming that you have the permanent financing. Receive a lump sum, or if you have the permanent financing, they receive a portion as a lump sum and the rest as contract assistance. Linfield High School will receive reimbursement in fiscal 06, so next year as a part of the second round. The total approved construction cost for those projects is $48.6 million, and the state will pay Linfield $30.1 million. Masconoma is number five on the waiting list. Making that payment very soon, probably when the bands come due on that project in February. That project is a $54.6 million project, and the state will be paying $34.1 million in a lump sum. There are some issues in financing there, and we'll be probably quite that amount, but that will be coming very soon. North Reading has the Hood Elementary School, a $4.9 million project, which will be closed. Originally scheduled to receive reimbursement in 05, will receive reimbursement in 05, but will receive it as a lump sum. Will receive $3.1 million from the state. Reading has three projects. Alice Barrows, the high school, and the Sunset Rock Lane project. These projects total $69.1 million. The state will pay $4.3 million. The Alice Barrows School was originally slated to receive its first payment in fiscal 09, and now we'll receive it in fiscal 05. The Sunset Rock Lane also was scheduled in 08, and we'll receive it in 05. And the high school would have received its first reimbursement check in fiscal 18. So still 14 years from now until that was going to be funded. Under the new program, we'll receive payment in fiscal 08. Moving over to, I already mentioned Masconoma, but moving over to Ipswich, the Winthrop Elementary School, this is a smaller project, but some of these repair projects are just as important to the school. This is one that would have received a $486,000 project, would have received reimbursement in fiscal 17, and will receive it in fiscal 08. So again, accelerated by 9 years with the payment. This, that's sort of a summary of the waiting list. And I know there are a lot of communities out there that are looking at future projects as well. As Jeff mentioned, there's a moratorium in place that for 3 years in order for us to be able to catch up with the backlog to be able to start working on these new projects, we need a little bit of breathing room. The other thing, though, that's going to be going on during this moratorium period is that the authority is going to be developing new regulations to govern this program going forward after July 1st, 2007. There are a couple pieces to this. One is a consideration of all kinds of factors that go into school construction. We're obviously going to start with the Department of Education regulations and rules and look at whether those are appropriate for the program. We're not going to throw those out of hand. We're going to look at them and consider what parts of the Department of Ed regulations make sense, what don't. Other factors that need to be considered are things like potential use of prototype school plans, consideration of environmental factors, green school issues, maintenance costs for schools, considering how that should factor in to decisions on school building, public-private partnerships to build schools, financing for charter schools, collaboratives, lease purchase agreements. There's a whole host of things. There are about 20 to 25 factors listed that the authority is supposed to consider over the next year and prepare a report to the legislature and say, these are the factors we think should be considered. This is what we think we can do by regulation. This is what we'd like you to do by statute to keep this program going. The other big thing that we're going to be doing in the next year to sort of set the stage for future reimbursement is a facilities study of all 1,900 school buildings in the county. This is going to be an enormous undertaking. I think, though, it's a very necessary undertaking because the new program isn't going to have waivers. There won't be, you won't submit after July 1st, 07, if you don't get approved. You'll just be on the list and you'll be at the top next year. You'll have to resubmit next year and compete against the projects in 08. And if your project still doesn't measure up, you still won't get approved. So in order to have this kind of rigor in the program, we're going to have to have a very good understanding of what some of the physical needs of the buildings are in the state. Also, obviously, there'll still be other factors like overcrowding factors, demographic factors, things like accreditation laws will still enter into the consideration. But when we're dealing with the physical factors, we're going to have a good baseline understanding of what's involved with the facilities statewide to be able to make good decisions about which schools ought to be getting funded for physical deficiencies and which should not. That will all take place, as I said, through June 30th of 2005. And then from June 30th of 2005 to June 30th of 2006, the authority will go about writing regulations. And those regulations will be put together. There will be proposed regulations out by January 1st of 06. The authority will then hold at least 5 meetings statewide to get public input on the regulations. There will probably be more, I would expect, but a minimum of 5 under the statute. And then the final regulations will go into effect July 1, 06, which gives communities a year to get ready with the regulations. I think that the question that is raised in a lot of these forums, and I think probably will come up tonight, is what do we do during this interim period when we really need to build a school? The legislation does provide that you can submit a application for a new school retroactively without penalty. The problem that you're going to face going forward, particularly if you're doing a lot of planning in 05, is that you're not going to know what the rules are. So what we would caution schools to do is to think very hard about whether this is the kind of program, the project that's really going to land in that kind of upper echelon of critical projects. Is this something that could not have waived? Is the leaky roof or asbestos problems or things that are real concerns of an immediate nature? It doesn't mean that you can't go forward on other projects, but to the extent that you do, you're taking a risk that when July 1st, 07 comes around, and you submit your project, there may be another 50, 60 projects all coming in at the same time, and yours may not be the most highly ranked of the projects. So we would say, be careful with that first submission and moving too fast on some of these projects. There won't be any benefit for having an application on July 1st or 07. There'll probably be a window of 3 months, 6 months, something like that, to submit the application. And having it in on the very first day will really benefit you. And so I would just say be cautious with that. So that's what the authority has been up to. We've been trying, the other sort of piece of it is trying to get the authority established as an entity, and that's trying to hire staff, find office space, and that sort of thing. We had one meeting already. The authority approved the payment of the contract assistance payments in September. We made those successfully on the 29th. We're having another meeting tomorrow. We'll start working on some of the setup of the authority. We're hoping to make a recommendation on office space and hopefully get moving on, get an office established, start hiring some staff, and be able to serve you better. Because at the moment, Jeff is helping out some other people in the treasurer's office, but at the moment I'm the only person working, or not really working for the authority, because they still work for the treasury, but I'm the only person officially on the authority's payroll, I guess, but just officially working for the authority. So my number's out there, a lot of people are calling me, I've been trying to return calls as quickly as possible. There's a lot of questions on this, as I'm sure you know, we've dealt with these problems before, changes in scope, issues with audits, those sorts of things. We're trying to be as responsive as we can, but as I said, it was a hard start. We had to go right into this, and we're doing the best we can to get it going as quickly as possible. But please be sensitive to the limited resources and try to get into it as quickly as possible. We're extending deadlines on audits. If we have deadlines and other things that come up, we're trying to be as helpful on that as we can. We also understand that you may have construction issues that have to be answered on the spot immediately. And if you have those, you need to call me, and I'll try to deal with those. And we're certainly talking to the DOE, we're trying to work with them to keep a consistent approach. We're trying to keep that as consistent as possible. If you have received something from DOE, it's going to be monitored. That often includes changes in maybe the numbers that you see on this on these sheets. These are numbers as submitted initially, and there may have been scope changes, but these have increased. Don't worry about that, you're okay. If you have a letter back from the DOE, we have it as well. We'll be updating that. It's just the process of getting through that. I think that has covered all the high points on that. Jeff has any more?
Just two quick comments, and then we'll open it up for questions. Two other things I want to mention. One is, I think you, in passing this reform legislation, the legislature really did fight off a big problem and solved it in a pretty creative way. A lot of people had a lot of input into that, doing it. And there's two aspects to that reform that I want to talk about. One is the financial reform. We've taken this program off budget, dedicated revenue to it, to make it predictable from a city and town standpoint. We've also put the program in somewhat of a fiscal box, if you will. In the future, there will be no waiting list. Revenue source will determine how many projects get approved in a given year. There's some hard limits in the legislation in terms of how many dollar value of projects that can be approved in the future, so that the program, having reformed it now, will be running for 40 years from now, and that it really is a fiscal reform that's going to have some legs to it, and not the kind of thing that has to be revisited in 2 or 3 years because we just did a band-aid and did some patchwork to it. The other thing that maybe the representatives want to talk about is construction reform. There's a companion piece of legislation that went through separate from SBA reform, but has a lot to do, intersects with the SBA program, and that's construction reform. There's a major package of construction reform, probably the most significant in terms of the public sector in the last 30 years, which was passed by the legislature pretty much contemporaneously with SBA. Made a lot of changes to how projects are bid out, how subcontractors qualified, requires professional project managers on projects of any significant size, allows cities and towns some options such as lease purchase, putting construction managers at risk, will, for the first time ever, make public evaluation of contractors so that when cities and towns are going out and choosing contractors for schools or for any other project, they know whether they're a good one or one that has had a lot of problems in the past. I'm not necessarily an expert on it, but I don't know if the representatives would comment on it. But a very significant piece, hopefully, in the future should make all public construction and school construction easier and hopefully cheaper and more likely to come in on time and on budget. And with that, pass it back to the
representatives. I would say that the construction reform was a comprehensive and consensus piece, where that you can imagine a lot of disparate parties coming and giving a little bit from their perspective. I'm not going to talk long about it. I had the good fortune, hopefully the good sense, to appoint my colleague here, Brad Hill, to represent ACCAR, because he's kind of the expert. So I'll let you know.
Well, we met for almost a year with groups who wouldn't even speak to each other for years and years. You had union members who wouldn't speak with groups, and they all came together in a very nice way. We had a compromise bill that I think we're very proud of, and you should be as well. And what it does, it gives you a menu that you can choose from when you go forward with your big construction projects. And you touched on a couple of the big ones. Qualifications of construction managers. Currently, you go, you just put your name on a board, and you hope to get hired. Well, now DCAM is going to qualify you to be able to go out and apply for these jobs. And as you said earlier, if you've been on a project and it wasn't a very good project, and you didn't do very well, you're going to have a report card filled out on them, and it's going to be open to any municipality to go to DCAM and see how they did on a former project, so you can grade them yourselves and have a little bit more information as you move forward. We're giving you the opportunity to have a construction manager at-risk program, which we've never allowed before. The state has taken advantage of this on some of the port construction. But in terms of schools, in terms of town halls, we've never allowed this to happen before. And what this does is bring a construction manager on board as you're putting together your plans, as you're putting together your engineering, so that you don't have as many change orders throughout the project. What we came to find is you have your engineer, you have your plans all put together before you have your construction manager or the manager of the project. The manager then looks at the plans and says, I can't work with this. We have to have all these change orders throughout the whole entire project. Well, now we're saying, bring the construction manager on board right from the start, and if there's a problem, it comes off the construction manager's bill. Not all these laws. What I can do, if you want to know what the construction reform bill was, just contact me at Brad. We'll get you the whole bill. Yes, we have a nice summary of what it does. It increases some of the criteria for sub-bidding law, which the municipalities asked us to do. We increased quite a bit. That's where the consensus was built between the union, the MMA, and the people of that sort. We came together, we came, I think, good consensus on some of the numbers you asked us to look at and have been very favorable. Design build, qualifications for CM and the builders, which I think is a major piece. There is a controversial piece, you probably read about it in the MMA beacon, where we are saying that if you have a project that's owed for $1.5 million, I believe it is, and I'm doing it by memory, so don't hold me to that. We're saying to you, you have to have a qualified construction manager on board for this project. They qualify. They have to be qualified. We came to find, not so much in our area, but in the western part of the state, down in the Cape, they were hiring people who had no clue what they were doing about managing Masconomic High School. They had people who worked for the town, or someone they knew, managing a huge project. And didn't know what they were talking about. We saw a lot of cities and towns who had groups of individuals who made all the decisions on the change orders who didn't really know what they were talking about in terms of construction. That's where all these problems were starting to happen. So we said, anything over a certain amount, you're going to have to hire that person. We believe if you do that, the money that you will save by hiring that individual will be worth the money that it costs for that individual. We hope to be approved by them. If you want any further information, the construction reform was a companion piece. The governor had proposed it as part of his original SBAB reform, but we separated the two so that we could do a very convoluted, as you can well imagine, on both sides. But we're very happy with both reforms, and if you want copies, we can have them.
The one thing you did mention was that it went into immediate effect.
Yes. Put an emergency preamble on it.
So it went into immediate effect. We have an issue with that. We have one of them.
At this time, if you've got any technical questions or any other further questions for the Treasury Department, this would be your opportunity. Please stand so we can hear you. When you ask, go ahead.
We have a project that is completed, it's on the list to get reimbursed for good school.
Okay.
We've bonded that project.
You've already gone to permanent financing,
I believe so.
For the entire amount.
Right. So now we're in this lump sum payment. How do we deal with that issue?
Unfortunately, in that case, it probably won't be a lump sum payment. Quite logically, not knowing what the reform was going to entail, cities and towns went out and did what they've always done for SBA projects. You're not alone that a number of cities and towns went out to bond it because that's what they always did, and then we're hoping that the state would catch up. unfortunately, in situations like that, we can talk about a couple different options. Your bonds can be called in early, there's a possibility that we can fund an escrow. We may just decide that depending on the economics of it, we'll make payments to you over 20 years if the bonds are out for 20 years. If you had not gone to permanent financing and just get bands outstanding, it would have been much easier. Unfortunately, there are some rules with regard to tax-exempt debt. There are IRS rules about having 2 cents of tax-exempt debt outstanding for the same project. Not surprisingly, the IRS hates. IRS doesn't like tax-exempt debt in the first place because they tax the interest income. And they paid even twice as much at 2 cents of debt outstanding, really to fund the same project. But since the authority will be issuing taxes and debt to fund the payment to you, we may actually have to make those payments on the project, unfortunately. In that situation.
Ira? A number of questions. Following up on, Tim, your comments about the transition, we have an audit. It was due a few days ago for this building's reconstruction, which was completed in 1997. It took 8 years to get the audit, 7 years. Now we're being told that we really don't know what's going to happen. Do you have any idea whether some of the staff at the SBAB will be transferred over to your division?
Yes, we're hoping that a large portion of the staff will be transferred over. And we're certainly working with them on a regular basis in this transition period to have communications and keep consistency in everything. As far as the audits go, we have posted on our website, and there is a website on the mass.gov the mass.gov website that is the MSBA link, and we have posted some information there on things like audits. We granted a blanket extension for at least October 15th. We'll probably grant another extension beyond that, because it doesn't look like we will have a permanent location established by then, which is really, if you think about these audits, you know that there are boxes of material, so it's not a trivial matter to just say, oh, just send me the audit materials. We don't have a space yet to put them. It becomes a big stack of boxes in my office that I don't know what I'm going to do with. So,
we sent you that box about a week ago. So. It's going to sit there for
we are working on the audit problem is a huge problem. It's one of the first things that we're working on is figuring out how to address these audits, and we're going to have an aggressive plan to deal with them, and we will get going on clearing them off. There's a little bit of setup to get ready to do that first. We aren't going to change what's required as far as content of the submission. We may change the way that we look at it once it's in the office, and we are certainly going to try to accelerate the speed with which we deal with the clients. I think it's been a very big problem for cities and towns to have that adjustment kind of blindsided 10 years into a repayment process. So we will be working with you. We're going to have to obviously prioritize some of this backlog. We can't just do all the 350 backlog projects and then get around to the waiting list, because we've got to move money on the waiting list as well. So we'll be going on parallel tracks, but we're going to try to move them both as quickly as
we can. So we get
we may do some outside hiring of consultants, or we may bring in some temporary staff. We're looking at all the options, and I hope to really get moving on some of that stuff in the next week or so, really start.
Our big question, and I know that some other people are probably going to want to know this, the Masconomic project, the reserve on the reimbursement, you said we were going to receive $34 million. We only have $18 or $19 million left on permanent financing. Are you actually talking about an escrow account for a town like us that will receive all of the $18 or $19 million that we have to permanently bond and pay off the bands? In lieu of that, plus the difference in an escrow that will be paid out over 20 years, how clear is that, and will that decision come in February?
Yeah, we'll be able to make that decision before February. To the extent that...
So that's after the taxes are set in the three towns. There's no tax relief in FY05, correct?
That's our major problem.
Well, right. We can work on the numbers before that if the project has been finalized and give you as much advance information as we can.
But when we get...
Your bands aren't due until February, so it's going to be problematic for us to pay you before February.
When we get to setting our levies, which we're all in the process of doing, in fact, somebody might have already, Topsfield usually does it early, and Topsfield's here to talk about that. But when we go in the next month or two, we have to actually finalize that debt service.
Yeah, I don't know that we're going to be able to give you final numbers in the next month. Unfortunately, it's a little too quick for us.
So it's not an FY05 reimbursement?
Not an FY05 reimbursement.
No, the reimbursement can't be in fiscal year '05. Our intent is that to the extent that you have bands coming due and they represent the state share of your project, you can document that. And we're going to make a lump sum payment to you, given where you are on the list, you're very high on the list, and that payment honored before the time your bands are due.
I understand the concern.
It may not work in terms of, I understand the problem with setting the tax rate.
Tax rate, the first two tax bills are going to be estimated tax bills. You say tax rate November, December, for the rest of the year to make up everything. And usually when you send it in, you get certified to the DOI, they don't want to see the actual money as opposed to the amount and actual bills. That means something you have to work with the DOI on setting tax bills, because that means that for the FY05 portion, with no actual reimbursement, people in the three towns are going to get hit, and then theoretically caught up next year. That would be a real burden.
I mean, plus we have band interest, as Susan Gibson has tell you, that we deal with in the budget as well. And again, it's hard to believe that other towns that are earlier in the tax rate setting process haven't already brought that up. The DOR hasn't been sure.
It's come up a number of times. I think the best way I can tell you is that work with you. If there's some way we can give you enough information that it can have an impact on the setting of the tax rates, we'll try to do that. What I can tell you is that to the extent that you have short-term financing on this project that's going to do this fiscal year, we're going to make a lump sum payment to you so that you don't, so that you can pay it off. That includes paying our share of the band interest that you've incurred today, not just the interest on the band that happens to be coming due this year, but the band debt interest that you paid in prior years, which is also a qualifier expense. So,
but when you work it out in February, then it's likely that the difference, in our case, correct me if I'm wrong, the difference between $34 million and $19 million will go into some sort of an escrow account that the regulations will then decide how
will be
divvied
out. Escrow account will establish payments that parallel your bond issue so that you can subsidize the bond issue to the extent that some of your permanent bond issues really are sure.
And we'll get a portion of that in L5 as well?
Yes.
That's significant.
Yes.
That's $17 or $18 million over 20 years that we don't receive subsidy for now, that has already increased our tax rate, would have an impact on the FY05 rate if we could have a communication with the Department of Revenue.
We'll do what we can. I'm not sure we're going to have enough information early enough. That's just like a function of the timing, but we'll do what we can.
I just have one more question, and then I'll get off the floor here. I'm a little concerned about the lack of clarity with respect to reopening of the waiting list in July 1st, 2007. You'll be developing through regulation 20 or 25 criteria and be going throughout the process to change all that, which is understandable, and re-rate the whole process on some sort of needs-based, non-political process here. We trust it'll be non-political. But beyond that, what I'm really getting at is, will timing of the application have any role as the previous SBAB application process?
The rewriting of the regulations is mandated in the statute. The legislature mandated them to take a thorough review of the regulations and the criteria that are in the statute and report back and develop new regs and have them in place at least a year before the moratorium is up. So having new regs in place at least by July 1st, 2006. Even though the authority can't, again, the restriction in the statute, can't accept new applications to approve projects until July 1st, 2007.
But annually, the decision to award $800 million for the projects will be within a 12-month period. There'll be some sort of timing cap or deadline.
Yeah, there'll certainly be a deadline for when the applications have to be in. But I guess what I was, the first part of the answer to your question was, you have your application in at 12:01 a.m. on July 1st, 2007. It's not going to give you any priority over anybody else who, you know, submits their application within the deadline. The legislature also mandated in the statute that the new authority is never going to have enough waiting list and develop the kind of long, the big problem that we have now, that each year we'll be able to accept that, you know, we can accept it, we can receive as many applications as people want to submit. And we're going to be limited as to how many of those applications we can approve based on some hard dollar caps that are written into the statute of how much money is actually received each year.
Generates another question. For those towns and cities that are not within the 800 million or don't have approved projects, because of either the funding limit or just didn't make the criteria that, that needed to get funded, there won't be a carryover. They'll be starting all anew.
There will not be a carryover. We'll start new. We are mandated to look at anybody who was rejected in the prior year. They were rejected solely because there wasn't enough money. But if you're rejected in year one and you reapply in year two, you're going to have to compete with all the other applications that are received in year two. There won't be a waiting list. There won't be any priority if you're rejected 1 year for reconsideration the next year.
I guess we have three questions. The first one, is there any room for interpretation of the authority or is it all state employees?
The board itself is a seven-member board, which includes the treasurer, the chairman, the commissioner of education, the secretary of administration and finance, and four members that were appointed by treasurer met in some specific criteria that were written in the statute. Two of whom had to be educators, two about curriculum and teaching, and two of whom had to have instruction or design experience in educational facilities. All those people have been appointed. In addition, there's a 17-member advisory board, which are representatives from a number of different organizations, superintendents, mayors, unions, construction industry, architects, I'm sure I'm forgetting the other 10, but there's wide representation on the advisory board that would advise in regard to both regulations and the regular business of the board.
And of the board members, one is a former school committee chair, who is also a teacher, and another of the board members is a former superintendent.
The second question is maybe it's a two-part question. I'm sure. The reimbursement will be based on the audit after the burden of the terms of this?
In the future, no. The reimbursement rates are set at the statute. So, you know, the percentage reimbursement that you're going to get, first of all, for all the old projects that we invested in, grandfather did at whatever rate it was, there is a formula set in the statute for the reimbursement rate, you know, the percentage rate. That's based on a formula that was originally put in place in 2000 and was changed slightly in this legislation. What gets reimbursed has been established by DOE regs for how many square feet, how many classrooms, the dollars per square foot. Those were set in DOE regulations, and those will be honored for any project that's on the waiting list. The audit process, generally speaking, is just before we make payments on any of these projects, assuring ourselves that we spent the money on the project, that we didn't change the scope of the project from the one that was approved by DOE, and things of that nature. And that, you know, that there wasn't anything that was paid for that wasn't allowable cost of the DOE rent. In the future, what we'd like to do is, since we're going to be making lump sum payments, basically do the audit at the time to finish the project, and have you one check for a lump sum.
I guess I'm going to go back and restate the question. Is that rate going to be applied to the total cost of the project before you temporary interest, a permanent interest, less any disallowed cost?
It will not be applied to any permanent interest. There's a specific provision in the statute that says that the authority can no longer reimburse permanent interest that is paid after, that is issued after July 1, 2004. So there's clearly a thought that it's going to be a lump sum payment. So if you go to permanent financing, finance the whole thing, you'll get contract assistance, but you won't get it for the interest on that permanent financing. You'll only get it for the principal. So you do need to think carefully about permanent financing. If you advance, if you had to roll your advance for another year for some reason, if you had significant issues with substantial completion and you're still adding things and you decide you want to roll your advance and get complete payment at the end, then you can still get band interest. But we're probably going to try to pay as much as possible in after the project is done, that maybe as a lump sum. It may not always be 100%, it may be, we're talking about 75-25 initially, but it may be in some cases that we're able to get 95% of your reimbursement, hold another 5% open to deal with several issues, and then we pay you again a year later the other 5%. But you will not be able to get any impermanent interest.
Unless it was on bonds issued
before July 1.
Those would still qualify.
Currently blended after July 1st, 2004. Any interest in the
and this is not included. It's not reimbursable.
Now, if you're bonded for your share, that's fine. I mean, that was always your share. If you bonded for more than your local share of the project, and you did it after July 1st, 2004, you know, 3 months ago, that is not eligible for reimbursement. The interest is the principal, obviously, because we owe you for our share of the project. So what I will do is give you my card and give you a call. We can talk through it.
Is there a difference between new buildings and new buildings that we want to attach to the building as far as the criteria for payment?
There's not a difference in the criteria for payment. There is a slight increase to reimbursement rates for innovation projects over the 200. Yes, right. As far as criteria, there probably are some minor differences, but I think they're pretty general in saying there is a bias in the statute, and this has been there for a while, but it's continued in the new legislation for remodeling over new. One of the three principles, the main three kind of guiding principles for the authority improving school buildings is the preservation of open space. It's also thoughtful community development. And the third guiding principle, I think, is consideration of overall cost effectiveness of school buildings. So those are there is a guiding principle for the whole thing that is to try to renovate where possible.
Okay, that's my point. There is something more to a renovating.
You get a little bit more in your reimbursement. And there's also a bias in the overall statutory framework for renovation. It doesn't mean it's pretty small bias, but there is a slight bias.
And the minimum is 30%.
The minimum is 31%.
31%.
And then it's added on our then we add on factors for
the. And the older one was I think 38%. And then we add on things, but in no event would you get less than 50%. Now I think it's 31, but no, it was 40%.
So it's each criteria, you need a criteria on that, your percentage of the
what? Yeah, there's basically three factors in the formula. One is a base rate, which is now 31%. The second is a factor that's added on depending on some wealth factors of the community, you know, the number of kids we're getting free lunches, where you stand in terms of your property values compared to the state. Then there's a third set of criteria which kind of depend on the project itself, whether it's energy efficiency, incentive points, basically, that you're going to add on.
I mean, it was similar to what they had before as far as getting.
Yeah, the formula hasn't changed yet, except in one, two respects. The base rate has been lowered by about 8%.
Right.
And the extra points that you used to be able to get for hiring a project manager have gone away because that's now mandated under construction. But the incentive part of it, by and large, the wealth factor and the base rate are pretty much the same formulas as those before.
So you made a statement that you're going to give reimbursement for the projects complete, but I will not have submitted my papers, possibly by February, if I can have it, but at this moment in time, that's not the case.
Yeah, let me take that for, in general, speaking, there's a lot of projects that are on the waiting list that are done, so that's a different situation. If you're not completed by the time we're ready to get to you, we can do preliminary figures based on what you've spent and make a payment based on what you have spent if you're not done yet. So that, you know, if the whole project isn't done, we're gonna need some preliminary information from you, and I know you and Tim have been talking about providing that information. And we may be able to only make a payment for what we, you know, based on the preliminary numbers and where you think the projects are gonna come in, and for 75% of what our share is, we may not get the rest of it until you finalize your numbers. But we'll be prepared to make a large lump sum payment this fiscal year based on whatever you spent today.
The next thing that's a little bit unique about us is, as Ira said, we have permanently financed $30 million of our $54 million. I have been in contact with our financial advisor, and our bonds are not up. We are not able to recall those bonds at this time. And you had mentioned that if that was a possibility, that you may consider escrowing that money and then doing an advanced refund to pay that piece off, which then we can correct? The other option, which seems more likely, is that you would be putting that money in escrow and making payments to us, the principal and interest. That's what
I'm saying. You need to look at the economics of your bond issue and work through which option works best. But one of those two options would work. We'll either make, to the extent that you bonded for more than just the local share, some of what you bonded for on a permanent basis is really the state's and now the authority share. We do one of two things. If they were advanced refunding, your bonds are advanced refundable today, like people who advance refundable portion of them. If they're not advanced refundable now, they can be called in the future. We might be able to fund an escrow. Or the third option is that we just pour whatever portion of your permanent bond issue is really our share, we make principal and interest payments on whatever portion of it is our share. And start doing that now.
Is it possible to do a combination of those? The reason why I'm asking is to get to the point of whether it will have an impact, ultimate impact on the tax
rate. It may be, certainly it sounds like we're gonna be making some payments to you this year, to the extent that you've got payments in February, and to the extent that you've bonded for more than your share. Some of it's either going to be in the form of an escrow or in the form of annual payments to subsidize our portion of your permanent bond issue. And those payments, you know, to the extent that they relate to the long-term debt that you've already issued, those payments can start this year. There's no reason to pay.
One last point I would like to make is that
Our
you still have not ironed out the details of how you will be making your portion of the payment to principal and interest on the bonds that are outstanding for us. So ultimately, what that could mean is that when I do my assessment to the towns, I would be considering a percent reimbursement I'm going to get from the state, which means that I don't have these as towns. But if I don't give you a payment in a timely fashion, then I'm going to have to borrow money in order to make this could create additional costs for us throughout the life of the bonds. And I just want to bring this point up because there's the town officials here, and I want them to be clear that there is that possibility that we may have to actually borrow money in order to make those principal interest payments, in spite of the fact that we may be getting interest reimbursement from the state. And it's something that I'm concerned about.
Ira, did you have a follow-up?
Well, I think that's an important point that Susan made, that those payments, if they're handled in that manner, need to be clearly timed to help the cities and towns meet their obligations, and so that we're not doing any sorts of borrowing or capital programs. Because when we set this all up, a lot of us took out permanent financing and set up our debt structure based on the old SBAB payment schedule.
And there's no reason that you shouldn't have that, because that's the way the program always worked.
Right.
Until very recently, when the reform package came through, there was no expectation that there would ever be lump sum payments.
Including the first $30 million of permanent financing, that we sat there meeting after meeting trying to make sure that it would not be an undue impact on the town, the district, resulting in the
necessary. Do you have any comment about the timing of the $1 million in borrowing that we set forth to free the money up for the clearing of the waiting list in terms of the changing interest rates that we're now seeing in the bond market?
Bond for the state loan.
I know the bond for the state loan.
Is it my other life?
They're moving up.
I do all the bonding for the state in general. That's my day job. But I'm not doing this. We've given active consideration to the hedging program. We are at, you know, pretty historically low rates, and we obviously have a lot of money to move up the door in the next 3.5 years. It's not a typical situation for the state where we normally have an annual capital that we have to fund. We fund it on an annual basis given where rates are. We preserve our option to call our bonds back in when rates come back down. This is kind of an unusual situation in the sense that we had to start $4.5 billion in the red, given the size of the waiting list, and obviously change small changes in interest rates could affect dramatically.
You made a lot of promises that look wonderful, and I'm concerned that changing interest rates and just will affect it to the point where we'll have further delays. Being pessimistic that all of the reforms, as good as they sound, will really come to fruition.
I certainly understand it completely, given the history of the promises that have been made under the program. We have a pretty robust financial model that can even accommodate increases in rates. If you're looking at ways to ameliorate that or protect against the interest rate increases, I don't think that's going to be a problem. That will not affect how fast we can be able to get on the money. Frankly, I think the hardest thing for us, at least in the first year, is really the administrative part of it, in terms of figuring out how to audit and time things with demands, how to undo situations, kind of like the one that you're presenting us with, where permanent financing is more than the local share, and for very good reasons, and working out all those situations with the cities and towns. It's not going to be for want of having a financial capacity.
Yeah, I
have one general question. Would you also help out finance tenders for bonds and not follow them?
Doing an option, doing a voluntary tender is a possibility. Generally speaking, they're difficult to do. You have to track down the bondholders to try to convince a significant share of them to actually tender at a particular rate. It's a possibility if the city or town was really excited about that possibility to work with it. I don't know that we necessarily solve the problem if you get enough people voluntarily tendering, but it's a possibility.
If we were, for instance, to borrow, let's say, $50 million this January for the project.
Sorry, how much?
Well, $50 million. We're running out of results. And $20 million is our cost, $30 million here in the JDA. It sounds to me tonight like you're saying the best way to do that, if we think 20 years is a good period of time for our tax bill, we should borrow our portion over 20 years, and then we might do a 5-year or something shorter on your portion. And according to what you just said about interest, we should probably try to borrow zero.
What I think you ought to do is only bond for your local share. The timing of bonding for your local share is certainly up to you. Rates are good right now and are at pretty low rates. Don't bond permanently for the state share or the authority share of the project. Put that out in the form to the extent that you need to spend it before we're ready to reimburse you based on the estimates we've given you. You should put that into short-term bands. Don't put it out for a period of time, longer than our estimate of when we think we're going to be able to get to, because the only thing that's going to manage to do is delay the period of when we can pay.
Well, you're essentially saying we ought to, or we mustn't, continue to take 1 year debt out instead of doing.
It doesn't necessarily have to be 1 year debt, depending on where you are on the list.
I think it's like 3 or 4 years.
But for the high school, it looks like they're planning to debt